We're speaking this morning with Dr. Fritz Henn, who is a former director of biological sciences at Brookhaven National Laboratory and is currently a professor at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. And Dr. Henn is one of the primary authors on a new study about depression. And Dr. Henn, I wanted to begin this discussion by just stating something that's obvious to people in the field. We still don't really understand the mechanisms of depression, and I suppose in some sense that's a starting point for talking about your most recent series of findings.
Yeah, that really is. The problems are illustrated if you take a look at treatment results in depression, where about a third of people will get better if you don't do anything. About another third will get better if you use drugs correctly. And then the third that's left, maybe half of them can be well treated with treatments such as ECT. Psychotherapy, when given correctly, and there are targeted forms of psychotherapy for depression, will work on the milder cases, but again won't get you cure rates greater than 50%. So we've got a group of people who really cannot be treated, and it's a disease that causes, in the World Health Organization's estimate, it will cause the greatest morbidity of any disease in 2040 because it's rising where we're doing better with most other things. So it's a big problem, and it's a problem we don't completely understand. And the basis for this work was really to try to understand what the anatomy was that mediated depressive phenomenon, and then to try to get to the point of understanding what goes wrong in that circuit, where's the pathology. And we worked in my lab for many, many years with an animal model of depression, and we've generated a quasi-genetic model, an outbred model, in which we've taken animals who are very sensitive to stress and bred them till they're more and more sensitive and are almost naturally depressed, and bred their counterpoints to the point where they don't react to stress much at all. I call them my New York rats. They're very tough. And it was at that starting point when we looked at the brains of those two sets of animals and we found differences that I came to Cold Spring Harbor and talked to Robert Malyneau and Bo Lee. And that turned out to be a very fruitful collaboration and got me over here. The question is, where are these brains different and what's the control point in that circuit? And we centered on a very small structure called the lateral habenula, and Bo and Robert were able to show that it was activated about 15-fold more in the stressed rats and the helpless rats, the depression model rats, than it was in the resistant animals.
Where is the lateral habenula located in the brain?
The lateral habenula is this teeny little structure just on top of the thalamus under the ventricles in the midbrain.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's a little structure, but it turns out that it's a structure that seems to control serotonin, noradrenaline, and dopamine.
And these are the monoamine neurotransmitters.
Those are the monoamine neuromodulators.
Neuromodulators,
really,
yes.
That modulate almost all of our brain functions. We certainly know noradrenaline is the fight or flight, very active in anxiety. Serotonin modulates a whole host of emotional states and is the target of almost all of the current antidepressants. And dopamine is really the drug that modulates the reward system. And what this work showed was that in depression, the reward system is really turned off by this structure, the lateral habenula. And that suggests that there's a constant signal of, quote, disappointment. I can't think of anything more depressing. And so that really makes sense. That led my old clinical team and I to consider targeting the habenula as a possible target in deep brain stimulation for that little group of patients who doesn't get better with anything.
Mm-hmm. And let me interrupt once more. Deep brain stimulation, if you could just say a word about what that is for those who are not familiar.
Okay, deep brain stimulation is a way of trying to alter the circuits of the brain to correct some kind of anomaly. And what's done is an electrode is placed at where you think a critical region is, and by adjusting the frequency and the strength of the stimulation, you try to normalize the functions through that circuit.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not a technique in which you cut anything out or lesion anything. It's a technique in which you actually go into the brain and try to normalize it.
You implant electrodes at the spot.
You implant electrodes in the spot, and you use those electrodes to retune the system.
Mm-hmm. So continue, please.
And this study that Robert and Bo and I carried out showed pretty convincingly two things. One, that dopamine was clearly a driver in this problem of learned helplessness, and by analogy, maybe in depression. And subsequently, with other collaborators, I've done studies in humans that have duplicated these results using imaging technology. So we're pretty sure it applies to depression. And it has suggested to us that the pathology is actually in circuits a little higher than the habenula, in the medial prefrontal cortex, an area that's been the focus of a lot of attention because another group using deep brain stimulation has focused on that area, Helen Mayberg, and probably correctly so.
Mm-hmm. And when you say a higher region of the brain, how do you mean higher in that?
I mean that it is an area that actually does some cognitive processing.
Mm-hmm.
And I suspect the habenula can be considered a small area that gets input from the limbic system, which is the emotions, and the cortex, which is the cognitive piece, and is basically an adding machine, adds it all up and then has an output
mm-hmm.
and controls these three amines. And we think that adding gets screwed up in depression,
mm-hmm.
and that's where the pathology might be. We think it's probably screwed up because the input, probably again from the medial prefrontal cortex, is too strong, too much glutamate input. And now my group is working on what is the pathology behind that glutamate overactivity.
Mm-hmm.
We actually think, not in this paper, but in work we're currently doing, that may actually involve not the nerve cells, the neurons, but the astrocytes, and that they aren't taking up glutamate rapidly enough.
Astrocytes are so-called helper cells.
Helper cells in the brain, yeah. And that would be a novel area for pathology, and we have to see whether that's really the case.
Mm-hmm.
But that glutamate is too active, that seems to be clear from data already in this paper.
And one of the notable things about the work that you're just publishing in Nature today is that you were able to reverse these learned helplessness, depression-like symptoms in the model animals, the rats, by using DBS and stimulating the lateral habenula.
Right.
What's the upshot of that? What does that point to in your mind? That success with DBS.
Well, that points to that being possibly a more efficient target for DBS in man,
mm-hmm.
and we're actually pursuing that. We've done the first patient, and we actually luckily have so far resulted in a total cure.
It's been tried in so-called Area 25, which is in the cingulate cortex?
No, yeah, it's a part of the medial prefrontal cortex.
Right.
And
this might be, whether it's an additional target or a better target in terms of its efficacy, that's one of the things that this work opens up onto.
Absolutely. And my hunch is it might be a better target because it's a place where not only does the cortical input come, but the emotional limbic input, the anxiety and restlessness that you sometimes see in depression, or the lack of energy that you sometimes see in depression, that's not cognitive, that's emotional. And both of those systems meet in the habenula.
Dr. Henn, thank you very much for speaking with us today.
Okay.